Welcome back. We'll start with the 15th chapter for Goh Cheng Leong that deals with hot wet equatorial climate. Now, based on the demands that I have been receiving, we are first covering the world geography section from Goh Cheng Leong. Also, I would like to let you know that we have started a separate channel that is Examrace Hindi, and that is meant specifically for the Hindi students, Hindi background students. So all these lectures we would be trying to cover that in the Hindi channel based on the response and the feedback that we get from you. So you can definitely go there, and those who are interested in Hindi can subscribe. Now let's start with the first thing here. What is equatorial climate? Now, I have a globe here. So what we are trying to understand for now is the regions of the world. Now, as you can see, you have the marking that is written here, and this marking here shows 0 degree. Okay. So all the countries that would lie on this line would be the equatorial nations. So these equatorial nations would cover 5 degrees north and south. So you have the Tropic of Cancer that runs here, nearly 23.5 degrees. So you have Tropic of Cancer and Tropic of Capricorn that runs in the south hemisphere, and the region around 5 to 10 degrees north and south would cover the equatorial countries. So as you can see, in Africa you would have basically the nations of Congo, then come down here you have the Indonesia and the Malaysia region. So you have the island groups of Indonesia and you have Malaysia. Now each of these regions have a specific tribe that we'll see later. So for example, in Congo you have pygmies, in Malaysia you have orang asli. Then coming on to the South American region, you have most of the regions of Brazil and parts of Ecuador and Colombia that could be seen here. And in Amazon you have the Indian tribe that is seen. So these are the basic tribes of those region. Now since this region is very close to the equator, we'll try to understand the characteristics of this region. Now the first and the foremost characteristic here is the equatorial type of climate that shows there is no temperature variation, or I would say a rather minimum temperature variation. Now this chart is the very important chart or crux of the today's lecture. So what we are trying to do is we would introduce this chart before each and every region that we would be discussing. So as you can see, you have the various regions here. So you have 9 and 11. So 11 regions we would be discussing one by one. The first one that we would be discussing today is the hot wet equatorial climate that lies in the equatorial zone, that is 0 degrees to 10 degrees north and south. So right now we are considering only the north hemisphere. The same would repeat inward down in the south hemisphere. Then you would have the hot zone that would include the hot desert, Sudan type climate and the monsoonal climate. Then you would have the warm and the cold climates, and under the warm you would have, the best way to remember this is MSC, so masters in science. So Mediterranean, steppes and China type climate. China comes towards the east. So in the globe, as you can see, you have China that lies here, and you have the Mediterranean type climate that would be seen here above the Africa and in the southern parts of Europe. So you would have Mediterranean, steppes and China climate. We can remember that this as MSC. And finally you have the British, Siberia and the Laurasia climate. So that would be the cool temperate climate. And in the northernmost zone beyond the Arctic Circle, you have the Arctic polar type of climate. So we would be understanding each of these climate sections in separate lectures. So for now we have the hot wet equatorial climate. Now as I said, there is uniformity in temperature. That means you have minimum variations in the temperature. Now again, in the equatorial region, let's take example of two places. One is Kuala Lumpur in Malaysia. That is a lowland city, and other is Bogota in Ecuador. Now this Bogota is a highland city. However, despite one being highland and the other being lowland city, both of these have an annual temperature range that has around 2 degree Fahrenheit of range. So the temperature range, that means the maximum and the minimum. So the difference between the maximum and the minimum temperatures would be around 2 degrees Celsius. Now this would vary nearby. So let's say in Singapore it's 2.3 degree Fahrenheit. However, if we go on to the extremes, you have Kyoto in Ecuador. So in Ecuador you have Kyoto, which has 0.7 degree Fahrenheit. So that's the range. So it's more or less a very constant type of temperature that runs throughout the year. There are no much up and downs that could be seen. Now what are the regions? As we already saw on the map, you have Congo in Africa. So you have Congo in Africa, you have Amazon in South America, then you have Malaysia and the East Indies Islands. All of these witness the equatorial type of climate. Now, the region 0 degrees to 10 degrees north and south, beyond that, a little near close to the 10 degrees, you would have trade winds that would come up. When these trade winds are modified by the coastal activities, you have the monsoonal influence that could be seen. Again, as we said, how the temperature is uniform, but how this temperature is moderated is a very, very important question. Now, this temperature is moderated by a few things. First is the land and the sea breeze that is coming close to the coastal areas. So you have regular land breeze, regular sea breeze coming up. Then you have the cloudiness and the regular precipitation or the regular rainfall that occurs in this region. As a result, it moderates the daily range of the temperature. Since the daily range of the temperature is moderated, the annual or the yearly range is moderated. The next is precipitation. Precipitation or rainfall is 60 to 100 inches. Now, there are few very interesting facts to know about rainfall. As I said, rainfall is distributed throughout the year. There is no distinct dry season. Okay, January would be dry or February would be dry. There is not even a single month like that. So you have throughout the year rainfall. That is very, very important. There is no month without the rain. Now, a very classic characteristic of a rainfall here. The rainfall here is maximum after the equinox. So the months with maximum rainfall are April and October. So there are 2 months in the year where you have a high peak of rainfall. So if I draw a curve, it would be something like this. So if you have, usually we show rainfall by bar graphs. So if you have bar graphs, you would have 2 bars that would be at the peak throughout the year. And if you have 2 months that are showing the peak, then automatically you can say that region is an equatorial region. So sometimes there can be a question where you are asked that you are shown a bar graph, and based on the bar graph you have to identify which kind of region it could be. So if there are 2 rainfall peaks that could be seen, that means it's definitely an equatorial region. So first you have April and October as the peak seasons for the rainfall, and the rainfall becomes lowest during the solstice. Now you have solstice, as we have already talked about, in June and December. So the least season where you can see the rainfall is June and December. So that would be the months with lowest rainfall. Now we have talked about the months with highest rainfall, we have talked about the months with lowest rainfall. However, as we move a little north and a little south from the equator, you have the monsoonal influence that comes into play. As a result, you have the months of rainfall that changes a bit. So in North Hemisphere, you have June, July, August as the months of rainfall for the monsoonal influenced region. And in the South Hemisphere, you have December, January and February as the regions, as the months for rainfall. Now next is relative humidity. Relative humidity is again very important. Now since the relative humidity in this region is very, very high, what becomes the scenario here is the region has high humidity. As a result, you have a kind of sticky atmosphere or atmosphere where you cannot perspire profusely, you can say. So you have the only way you can be relieved of this relative humidity or the sticky nature, I would say, is the coastal breeze, that is the sea breeze that are blowing through. Now again, a very unique characteristic of equatorial region is rainfall occurs by three ways. You have conventional rainfall, orographic rainfall and cyclonic rainfall. We have already talked about these three types of rainfall when we have covered the class on precipitation. Now, all these three types can be witnessed in an equatorial region. In an equatorial region, if there is a cyclonic disturbance, you would see convergence at the doldrum areas, and therefore you would have cyclonic rainfall. If there is a kind of small hilly area or a highland, you would witness orographic or relief rainfall. And again, conventional rainfall, which is most common. So every afternoon you have a kind of high temperature accumulation. As a result, you have torrential rainfall during the afternoons. That's again a unique characteristic of equatorial region. And what would happen is it's said that one day rainfall of an equatorial region in the afternoon that occurs is equivalent to the year-round rainfall that occurs in a desert area. So that's the extent of the rainfall that you can see. The next is the vegetation. Now the very unique feature here is this region is known for tropical rainforest. Now when we say tropical rainforest, these are the rainforests which you, first of all, there is no homogeneous strand. There is variety of species, variety of plants that could be seen in the region. Now again, you have good rainfall and good temperature. So you would have ample of growth. What would happen is the highest tree is grown here. Now when the sun rays come on, the sun rays won't be able to penetrate a lot. So you would have a kind of dense undergrowth that would be seen in this region. So this region is known for dense undergrowth and high forest area, and that forest area is not homogeneous or uniform. You have kind of species with flowering season, seeding season throughout the year. Since there is no one single species which would have a single flowering season, there are multiple species, so there is a kind of year-round season for flowering. So you can see flowers throughout the year across the equatorial region. You can see seeding that is occurring throughout the year. Again, there are long trees, as we said, then there are small trees and dense undergrowth that could be seen in these regions. Now again, they can tolerate shade. So all those plants which are located towards the growth that is located towards the lowermost regions can tolerate the shade. So they do not require ample of sunlight to reach. The next is the four different categories under which we understand the vegetation. The first is the variety of the trees. As we said, you have hardwood like mahogany, ebony, and then below the hardwoods you have smaller palm trees. Then you have climbing lianas. So these climbing trees are known as lianas. They are either epiphytic in nature or parasitic in nature. Then you have orchids, lalangs, that are the tall grasses and small ferns that could be seen. As we said, there are three distinct layers: the long trees, the small trees and the dense undergrowth. Now what is happening is this canopy, or the tree canopy which we can visualize here, is struggling for sunlight. So there is not enough sunlight reaching the lowest layers. Finally, you have the multiple species. As we said, there is no pure strand, no pure species. There is a kind of heterogeneous species that is seen. Malaysia forest, you can see nearly more than 200 species. Now, since there are so many species, if I want to extract mahogany or if I want to commercially exploit mahogany trees, it would be very expensive because there is no range of mahogany trees that could be seen in parallel. So I'll have to go within the forest picking one or the other. So that becomes very difficult. Therefore, commercial exploitation is very hard. Again, the hardwoods do not float on the water. So what happens is, as we'll see in the next chapter on tropical monsoons, for the hardwood trees, what you do is you lumber them out in the upland areas and you float them with water so that they reach the downstream region. We'll see in the next class how that works. So for now you can understand, so these hardwoods are very heavy and they do not float on the water. As a result, you cannot haul them. So it becomes nearly impossible to export them. That is one of the primary reasons that despite a lot of timber that is available in the tropical regions are still the importers of timber. So they have to import timber from other countries because despite the fact they have huge timber, they cannot exploit it, being a very costly affair. The next is forest clearings. Now, with the civilization coming up in the region, you have the forests that are cleared for the lumbering activities. So, you have cutting down of the trees, you have clearing of the forest patches for shifting cultivation, and because of that, you have a lot of secondary forests that are coming up. A good example is Belukar in Malaysia. You have secondary forests that come up. These secondary forests have less trees and a very dense undergrowth that could be seen here. Now, next is life and development. Now, first of all, let's understand the life. Definitely, since the climatic conditions are extreme, the life is very, very difficult. So, you have very sparse population that could be seen here. The population is mainly in the form of hunters, gatherers, or shifting cultivation I've seen. So, it's primarily the primary sector of economy that works here. Again, what is abundant here? You have lots and lots of food because there are many trees that are present. You have ample of rivers, ample of streams flowing through. So, what would happen here again is you would have lots and lots of fishes. So, since you have lots of fishes, you have lots of food that you can eat here. However, one important problem here is commercial exploitation. It's very hard to commercially exploit this region. So, if I want to draw roads, if I want to develop a railway, it becomes very hard because I have to clear out wild forest areas. So, there could be wild snakes, wild animals that could come up, and it becomes very difficult to work around in such a scenario. Even if worked around, the trees would grow at such a rapid rate that maintenance of that infrastructure would again become a very difficult task. So, some of the primary activities that the people here are engaged in, as we said, Amazon in Brazil, you have the Indian tribe that works and it gathers mainly the wild rubber. You have Congo region in Africa where you have pygmies tribe which gather nuts. You have Malaysia with Orang Asli tribe, which mainly work on the cane products. Besides these, you have lots of other fruit products like sugar, coffee, coconut that could be seen. Now, the next important thing here is the plantation cultivation. So, plantation was something that was brought around by Britishers throughout the world. And what they tried to do was they wanted the produce for the industrial waste. So, all the countries or the industrial waste wanted this produce. Now, where does the plantation came up? Plantation came up in rubber industry or rubber production and coca production. These are the two important ones. In India, it's tea production, tea plantations also. So, let's talk about rubber first. So, the natural rubber comes from Hevea brasilis. And what is important to understand is the first rubber that came was from the Amazon basin, and that was known as the para rubber. It was not the Hevea brasilis or the natural rubber. Now, Malaysia and Indonesia are the leading producers for rubber, and nearly one third of the production both from Malaysia and Indonesia contributes to rubber. Then you have Brazil, which is again an important producer. However, Brazil is not an exporter of rubber. Now, what's the reason that Brazil is not exporting the rubber? When it comes to Brazil, there are two important things. First is the disease infestation that could be seen here in the Brazilian forest. So, the trees are infected with diseases and it's very difficult to curb the diseases. And second is lack of commercial organizations. So, because of the lack of commercial organizations, the Brazilian forests do not work as a net exporter of rubber. However, they have a lot of rubber in the wild that is collected by the various tribes. Now, next is cocoa. Cocoa is mainly seen in West Africa. So, you have the West Africa region here that you can see on the map here. Now, this West Africa region, mainly you have Ghana and Nigeria. So, you have Ghana and Nigeria as the major producers for cocoa, and these regions worked as the plantation cultivation. Now, again, you have this region near the Gulf of Guinea that could be seen. Now, the next is the factors that affect the development of the equatorial region. As we said, climate is one of the major characteristics. So you have high temperature, high humidity. As a result, there is problem of sunstroke. There is lot of perspiration, so there is loss of energy. People do not have that vigor or energy to work throughout the day. Again, this region has dense forest growth. As a result, it's prone to various diseases. Common diseases here are malaria and yellow fever. Next is bacteria and insect pest. Now, these pests affect the crops. They also affect or they also cause disease in the human beings. So, one of the common disease here is plague. The next is the hindrance of the jungle for the development. Now, as we said, due to the dense forest area, construction or infrastructure becomes difficult. So, you have lalang, that is the tall grass, and these tall grass along with the thick undergrowth that could be seen chokes the crop. So, you do not have enough development for the crops. Again, maintaining the infrastructure here has high cost. So, some of the regions of Africa, that's Congo and Borneo, still do not have any modern communication lines. So, they lack modern communication lines as infrastructure limitation. The next is deterioration of the tropical soil that could be seen. So, what's happening over the time? There is lot of lumbering taking place, lot of shifting cultivation taking place. So, what happens to the tropical soil? When you have the dense undergrowth or the trees that are seen, they shed their leaves, and when they shed their leaves, they deposit as organic layer over the soil. This organic top layer is known as humus. So, humus is a fertile top layer that is seen. When you are cutting the forest, when you are clearing the forest, there is no presence of the, or there is lack of presence of the humus that could be seen. So, what happens ultimately is the soil fertility is affected. If the soil fertility is affected, the soil quality would be affected, and that would ultimately lead to lack of vegetation or lack of growth in that region. Again, as we said, there is difficulty in lumbering and there is livestock farming difficulty. Why does that occur? Now, lumbering, as we said, I am cutting down the trees. So, let's say I need mahogany. So, I want to cut out all the mahogany trees. So, if I have 100 mahogany trees that are in line, it's easier for me to cut those out. But if I have one mahogany here, another there, it would be very difficult for me to find each and every mahogany tree and cut it. That means there is lack of homogeneous strand or similar strands of trees that could be seen, and therefore the lumbering activities become difficult here. So, you also do not have these trees that are seen here are hardwood trees, and they are heavy, so they do not easily float on the water. So, again lumbering becomes difficult. Now, when it comes to livestock farming also is not a good option. The only two animals are the buffaloes and the bullocks that are seen here, which are considered as the beast of burden, and they give milk and beef, but not in that quantity as the cattle in the tropical region do. So you do not have good livestock farming that could be seen here. Again, one very important reason for lack of livestock farming here is that grasses are tall and coarse. As a result, they are not nutritious. Since they are not nutritious, they are not beneficial to the cattle population or the buffalo population, and there is no good livestock farming that could be seen. There are no meadow grasses that are grown, so those are not meant for the domesticated animals. Again, one important reason is the testis fly disease, and this testis fly disease is also known as Nagana disease, and this is a disease that affects the domesticated animals. And once you have the domesticated animals that are affected, you do not have good livestock farming. So, with this we cover the chapter 15 of Goh Cheng Leong. We would be covering further sections which deal with the various climatic sections in the upcoming lectures. For any doubts, you can leave those as comment below the video. Have a good day.